Oh, no, it took me several Medicare talks to really get that out of my mouth, right. So now I'm ready for this. Jim, please, thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you, Gina. All right, so we're going to go through a lot of slides. Some of this is going to, it'll get more complex as I go through it, so feel free to stop me, or we can spend some time afterwards going through some of the slides. So what we're first going to cover is just some background in terms of Social Security and where it started. And where it started was in 1935, the Social Security Act was signed into law by FDR. Then we had in 1939, they added to the program already, and they added benefits for spouses, survivors, and minor children. So originally, it was only set up for retirees. So it only took 4 years, so they're already starting to tweak the program around. Now, here's the issue. The Social Security Handbook has 2,727 rules attached to it. This is what makes it so complex. And this number has actually gone down over the last few years. Now, the first thing we're going to talk about, and I will use throughout the presentation, you'll see some acronyms that are going to be very popular. The first one is FRA, and that stands for Full Retirement Age. So this is when you can start receiving what Social Security calls full benefits. So the way you read this is the year of birth is in the left column, and then the full retirement age that applies to it is in the right column. So this is just the way it's set up whenever you have your full retirement benefits and what ages apply to it. Now, everybody might recognize this, and it comes in a little bit blurry, but this is an example of a Social Security statement. So you used to get these every year around your birthday, a couple months beforehand. Now the Social Security Administration has stopped sending them every year. They send them out basically every fifth year. And they've talked about maybe increasing the frequency of which they mail statements to you. But the next acronym that we will refer to a lot in here is PIA, Primary Insurance Amount. To simplify it, just think of this term as being a Social Security benefit. Now, the way the system works is you get Social Security credits. So you get one credit for every $1,300 you make in earnings, and you pay Social Security tax on. Then the maximum you can earn in the course of a year is four. So for four quarters in the year, you can get a total of four credits. Now, what gets a little bit confusing is that whether you earn $5,200, which would be the $1,300 times four, or $60,000 in a year, you're going to earn four credits, and that's the most you can achieve in a year. A couple of other points about these credits. Now, what makes it even a little more confusing is that you can earn the $5,200 in one quarter, and you're going to get credit as if you earned four credits for that year. You don't have to earn $1,300 in every quarter. You can earn the $5,200 all at once in 1 month, and you'll have your four quarters for that particular year. And you've then, again, maximized the amount you can earn towards Social Security for that year. Now, what it takes to actually qualify for retirement benefits is you need to earn 40 credits or 10 years of work, just simply taking 10 years times four credits. The other part that is good to know, and I get this question a lot, is if you have a gap in employment for whatever the reason might be, it doesn't matter. It's all about the 40 earned credits. You can earn that every other year, or you could have a gap in employment for a couple of years. It doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be consecutive. Now, how it's actually calculated. This gets a little bit more confusing, but at age 62 is the earliest age you can start to receive Social Security retirement benefits. And what happens is that Social Security is running the calculation to calculate your estimated benefits based on what you have earned throughout your work history. So what happens is that they take the highest 35 years of earnings are average. And this term, AIME, stands for Average Indexed Monthly Earnings. So that's another acronym you will see throughout this. But the way this works is that even though it's 40 credits, that you need to qualify for retirement, what ends up happening is that it's the top 35 years of earnings are actually used to calculate your benefits. So if you're working and you've worked for 45 years, 35 top years will be used. So if you have some years where your income is really low and you maybe want to plan to continue to work a few more years, you might see your projected benefit go up because of this, because it's the top 35 years. Yes,
Sylvia? That doesn't have to
have to be consecutive 35 years. There's breaks in those two.
Exactly. Yep, they kind of look at that bottom line and however you've earned your credits throughout time. It doesn't matter. And I'm sorry, for those in the back, the question was, does this part have to be consecutive as well? And it does not. Now, a couple of just basic facts regarding Social Security. So the average monthly benefit for 2017 for a single individual is $1,360. For a couple in 2017, it is $2,260, just to give you some perspective of what some of the averages are. The maximum earnings limit. So what the earnings limit is that if you made $200,000, Social Security taxes are not taxed on the entire $200,000. There is a cap on your wages that are taxed for Social Security. In 2016, the cap was $118,500. And then it inflates every year. And you can see for 2017, it's increased to $127,200. The tax rate is 6.2%. The maximum payout at FRA stands for full retirement age. And for 2016, the maximum that somebody could make at your full retirement age, which typically is going to be 66 for most people right now, was $2,639 last year. It's increased now to $2,687 in 2017. Now here's one of the big parts, one of the main benefits of Social Security is that it is an inflation adjusted benefit. So a lot of times if you have a company pension plan and the pension starts to pay out, almost all of them pay out a monthly rate and then it does not inflate. There are some that do, especially if you work for a governmental entity, you might have an inflation adjustment. But most pension benefits do not inflate, or if you have an annuity that's paying on an income stream, unless you pay for it to inflate, it typically will not inflate. Social Security does inflate. Now the problem with that has been, from anybody that's receiving Social Security, is that inflation has been very low for the last, we'll call it 16, 17 years. To give you an idea, in 2016, inflation was zero, and this year, going into this year, was 0.3% for benefits paid in 2017. Now, what makes this really confusing is that you'll hear CPI, which stands for Consumer Price Index, thrown about in a number of different ways. There are hundreds of CPI calculations that are followed. For the one that's used for Social Security is called CPI Workers, which is where these come from. There has been proposals over time. There's actually a CPI index for elderly people. So it would be a little more maybe applicable for somebody that's in retirement, but it's not used. And look at the inflation rates, 2.1% in 2016, and then they haven't released it going into 17 yet, but the prior year was 0.6%. So it's a higher rate. The problem is that the inflation adjustment has been so low, you're not seeing your benefits increase a lot year to year. And that's, unfortunately, there's no firm changes yet to this program in terms of the inflation rate. Now, the most frequent question that I get asked is, will Social Security be there for me? So right now, the numbers that are thrown about is that there's a trust fund for Social Security that pays out the benefits to the beneficiaries. It's fully funded until the year 2034. And then what a lot of people think is that at 2034, there's no benefits left to be paid. And that's actually not accurate. However, starting in 2034, or after 2034, the trust fund would only have enough money to pay 75% of whatever your projected benefit is. It's not like it just falls off a cliff and goes away. It's just that the fund is projected to not have enough money to pay whatever you're talking about receiving at this point in time. That's really where the problem is. So it's not like it just goes away in 2034. It's just the benefits are going to be reduced for everybody unless there's some changes made to the system. And unlike the federal government, where you can have deficit spending, which then adds to our U.S. debt, the rules are set up for Social Security. You cannot deficit spend. So that creates a problem in terms of trying to manage this on a year-to-year basis. Now, what would it take to restore solvency to the system? There's a number of things that have been thrown about over the years. First one is that you could increase the earnings subject to Social Security tax. That was that number from before, which was about $127,000 or so for this year. You could increase that maximum earnings amount so no more money would come into the system. You could raise the normal retirement age or the full retirement age. You could lower benefits for future retirees. That's probably the least popular item that exists. You could reduce the cost of living adjustments for all retirees, but they're already extremely low to begin with. Or you could raise the Social Security tax rate, that 6.2% rate. So none of them are extremely popular, but something would have to be done to try to let the system grow for a longer period of time. It was never meant to be set up to run for this long of a period because life expectancy has increased so much since 1935. That's kind of what's causing the structural problem. And because there's the population in our country, the baby boomers retiring and taking more funds from the system, less people paying into it, is also causing a problem too. Now, how can you estimate your Social Security benefits? So what's really nice is that while they don't send the earnings statement every year now, you can go to the Social Security website, which I have right here, and you can actually obtain your statement there. You have to sign in, set up an account. They'll ask you security questions, just like any login you might have to a bank account. And you can go on, and it's pretty easy to use, and you can go on and get your estimate. You'll actually see your statement that looks like what used to be mailed to you. So you can do that, and then you can click on, there's a section for estimating your retirement benefits. So what it allows you to do is it allows you to take all of your exact data for your work history, and then you're allowed to plug in for future years what you think your earnings will be, and then you can kind of let the software run a calculation for you what your benefits could be. So it's pretty smooth, and then there's other calculators that do exist in terms of trying to get some idea of your benefits as well. And they're pretty helpful. And I will say, for as confusing as this is, the Social Security website has a really good wealth of information that's on the site. And getting, you know, going on and actually setting up an account for yourself makes a lot of sense because it's a pretty relatively user-friendly site, I'll say, whenever you get onto it. Now let's start talking about what some of these numbers actually mean. So Social Security offers income you can't outlive. It's not like it stops at a certain period of time. It doesn't matter. Once you start claiming your benefit, it'll pay until you pass away. So to give you just the idea of some of the numbers, if your monthly benefit is $2,400 today and you live 10 more years, you'll receive a total of $363,227 of benefits, assuming a 2.7% annual cost of living adjustment, which is pretty high right now based upon where things have been. But historically speaking, those are more accurate numbers in terms of averaging out inflation over time. So, and this is all based upon life expectancy. So 20 more years, the benefit goes up to almost $800,000. And then 30 more years, it goes up to $1.369 million. Again, based upon the monthly benefit of $2,400 today, and a 2.7% annual cost of living adjustment. Now, another way to look at this is that if your monthly benefit is $2,400 today and the annual cost of living again is 2.7%, this will show you in monthly benefit terms, which is a little easier to get your hands around maybe. So in 10 years, the monthly benefit would be $3,133. In 20 years, $4,089. In 30 years, $5,337. Just a different way to look at the numbers. Now, changing your mind, what is that about? Well, if you started your Social Security, let's say you started at age 63 because maybe you lost your job and you wanted to start collecting on your benefit. And then, you know, 7 months later, you start another job. Maybe you don't need those benefits. You're actually allowed to withdraw your application for Social Security within 12 months of your first claiming. You have to repay the benefits you received, and then you can actually allow your benefit to continue to earn higher amounts. So it's just something that's really good to know in case that would apply. You can actually repay your benefits in those first 12 months. Now, once you reach full retirement age, you can also suspend your benefits from that point going forward until age 70 as well. But again, you got to repay the benefits, which can maybe be impractical in some cases, but you do allow yourself to get a higher benefit, which we'll cover very shortly on what that might mean. Now let's talk about the tax side of things for whenever benefits pay out. So the way Social Security works is that at most, up to 85% of what you receive will be taxed. So 100% of your benefit is not income taxed. At most, it's 85%. It's based upon how much income you earn. And the formal term is called provisional income. So it takes off of your tax return, your adjusted gross income, which basically is your gross income that shows up on the first page of your 1040. You add half of your Social Security income, and you add tax-exempt municipal bond income. So whatever that number equates to, we'll go to the next slide, is that the provisional income, if you have the filing status, let's look at married filing joint. If that provisional income is under $32,000, you pay no tax on your Social Security benefit. If it's between 32 and 34, up to 50% is taxed. Over $44,000, up to 85% is taxed. Then you have different levels for somebody that's filing single. That's the key thing is to realize is that if you do, what we find a lot of times with our clients is that when they reach retirement, and let's say they're not working anymore, their income drops off a lot, you end up with some really good planning opportunities where maybe you can have your Social Security not be taxed at all. Or at least you want to be aware of that as you're doing any impact on your taxes during the current year. You might have 1 year on your taxes where it's not income tax, meaning Social Security, but if you're not careful the next year, maybe up to 85% of it's taxed. So it's just good to know that there's some ways you can strategize around how to minimize your income taxes. Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me. On the single under $25,000, is that the Social Security amount, or is that plus if someone's working wage and Social Security?
Good question. Let me go back up. So it covers under this provisional income definition, which, if I go back to that prior slide, consists of your adjusted gross income of which earnings, interest, dividends, capital gains, any retirement distributions you might have. That's going to be under adjusted gross income. So the answer to your question would be yes. And then plus half of Social Security plus municipal bond income.
What if it was just Social Security and it was under 25, then you would have zero tax?
You'd probably be in good shape in a case, yeah. Yeah. Yes?
So if that income was from IRAs, that isn't included because that's not a bond, right?
But if you're taking money out of your IRA and it's taxable, it's going to be part of this number, the adjusted gross income. Yeah. Think about, like, if you're looking at your tax return, the first page of the return is going to have all of your income. One of the entries on there is for IRA distributions. If you're receiving a pension, that's taxable. That's going to be part of this calculation. I should probably have maybe a copy of the form on here just to kind of show all the different items. But everything we're talking about would be income taxed and would go into this calculation, which would then determine how this would fall for your situation. It's tricky. A couple of things, you know, you can focus on minimizing taxes on benefits is that, I mean, this revolves in some multi-year planning. But if your situation, what happens at age 70 and a half? If you have retirement accounts, the IRS requires you to start taking distributions. It's just the way they do it. They've let you have your money tax deferred for a number of years. At age 70 and a half, you're required to start taking money out. And it's in the first year, it's about a 4% withdrawal, meaning 4% of the balance of your retirement accounts you're going to be required to take out. So if you're trying to really plan the Social Security taxation benefit, you might want to run a preliminary projection of what that required distribution would be. And maybe if your taxes are relatively low, maybe you take down some of your retirement account monies now and maybe pay a really low tax rate versus waiting until age 70 and a half when you might have a much higher amount, which could cause your Social Security to be taxed. It's complicated, but there's ways you can try to minimize the situation as well. Now, you can also do what's called a Roth conversion, where you move a traditional IRA to a Roth IRA. Roth IRAs, if you follow the rules, the earnings on them are tax-free. Or withdrawals are tax-free, excuse me. And they're not part of that required distribution calculation. So if you have a really low tax bracket and you shift money from an IRA to a Roth, you pay taxes on what you shift over. But again, it might make sense because then at age 70 and a half, Roth IRAs aren't part of this required distribution calculation. I don't want to dive too much further than that for this point. I just want to make a few illustrations. There's ways to minimize your taxes that maybe can minimize Social Security, how much is going to be taxed as well. Now, just overall, when you're making any of these decisions, and this will become a little more clear as we go through the rest of the slides, is coordinating your Social Security income with your retirement income overall. So you want to, you know, think about the retirement accounts. I gave you a couple of examples of how you can maybe make some strategic moves to minimize some of your taxes. Look at your investment portfolio in terms of how you have your investments structured. If you have some investments that aren't very tax efficient, make sure they're in your retirement account. That'll probably lower your tax bill, all things equal. And then you also want to factor in, too, are you going to continue working into retirement as well? Because we're going to talk about some of the rules surrounding that, and I think maybe in the next couple of slides. So let's cover an example here. The impact of what we'll call improved earnings. So this example, we have Rebecca at age 60. Her earnings history, she had what they call average earnings. They don't define the number in here. But 1973 to 1979, no earnings from 1980 to 2000, and then maximum earnings, meaning that Social Security wage base we covered, she hits that maximum amount each year from 2001 to 2012. So what will happen at age 66, which is her full retirement benefit or full retirement age, if she stops working now, or, and again, that's at age 60, or keeps working until age 66. So here's the impact of it. So the way you want to read this in this first column is we have the age 66 benefit. If she stops working at age 60, it would be $1,722. But if she kept working until age 66 and maximized her wage base for Social Security, her benefit would go up to $2,181. Now let's look at it when we inflate it. And again, we're using 2.7% because we're talking about a really long time frame. So the benefit at age 85 for her would be, again, stopping at age 60, her benefit will have gone from $1,722 to $2,857. And then if she kept working until 66, it would go from $2,181 to $3,618 at age 85. And then the cumulative benefits, let's just look at the inflated dollars. At age 85 would be, again, for the first scenario, stopping at age 60, $538,000. And then if she kept working, the cumulative benefit, again, inflated, would be $682,000. The only thing I really want everybody to realize on this is that these decisions you make on how you handle your Social Security can be a really big deal. I mean, look at the difference between these two numbers just based upon this scenario. They're significant numbers over time. And with life expectancy increasing, you know, these numbers could even be much larger. So now, why delay benefits? Because the way Social Security works, between age 62 when you can first start to claim a retirement benefit, up to age 70, which is the last year Social Security will increase for you, there's a big difference. So this chart's a little noisy. Let me go through the way you want to read this. So we have the age over here on the left. The percentage of PIA, so PIA is primary insurance amount, think Social Security benefit, if FRA, full retirement age, is 66. So the way this works is that if you start at age 62, well, let me start this way. Age 66, you get 100% of that in primary insurance amount, the Social Security benefit. If you start at 62, you take a discount of 25%. You get 75% of your projected full retirement age benefit. Now, on the other side, if you wait till age 70, you receive 132% of your full retirement age benefit. So this goes up basically 8% a year from your full retirement age, if it's 66, until age 70. So what I tell our clients is that if you can have patience on that and you can pull that off, I can't guarantee 8% of return on anything. This is right now, under the current system, 8% guaranteed increase in that monthly benefit from full retirement age to age 70. So it's pretty significant. Now, what could cause you to take benefits early? Well, it could be that, you know, maybe your cash flow is going to require you to take money out of retirement accounts and you're going to pay taxes on that, and that doesn't make sense. Maybe that makes sense to take the early benefit to maybe preserve your investable asset base. Health issues. If there's concerns about health, whether it's you directly or maybe within your family history, maybe you want to take your benefit early, because the break even typically between whether you start at 66 or start at 62 is around 81 or 82 years old, meaning that if you waited until 66, then once you get out, or if you start at age 62, I'm sorry, your break-even point is basically the early 80s to whenever you would the decision should have been starting at age 66. So if health issues are a concern, then you want to consider taking the benefit early. I just want to make sure I explain this key point and how this works whenever you're making this decision. Sure thing.
Now, on a husband and wife,
yes,
they're totally independent decision. There's nothing tied together.
Not technically. And I actually have a section coming up where for spousal benefits, but it's not like one has to start, the other one has to. It is really independent. But there are some ways that the decision can be connected, and it's pretty interesting. Some of the ways you want to plan for that. Yes.
Question.
I'll go back.
Delaying your benefits.
Yep.
So if you delay 1 year, and say you're not working, you just delay it.
Sure.
Is there any difference between what you would get is if you actually worked at your input in, outside of the fact that you might be adding to your original benefit? I mean, your
kind of the your historical earnings,
right,
in that case?
Is there any difference?
It, you know, the bottom line will be, so the question is, so your question is, if you started at six,
I delayed a year, and,
right,
and I wasn't working.
Yep.
I would gain 8%.
Starting at this point, so at age,
right,
you're 40,
age
yep, that's right. Your benefit, your projected benefit will go up 8% a year.
So the only difference, if I worked a year and made money, the only change would be is if I was making more during that time, that changed what.
That's exactly right. Yep. It always looks at that bottom line, 35 top years of earnings to get your calculation squared away. Yes, ma'am.
Jim, if you're hitting a family max,
mm-hmm,
does it also increase 8% a year with your, if you were?
That's a great question. So one of the things I weighed whether I wanted to present or not is that the Social Security Administration, it's on your benefits statement, will show you a family maximum amount. So there's actually a cap for families that you can earn. So the question is, does that also go up by this 8% a year? I believe it does, but I've never looked at that specifically, but I believe it does, because I've looked at our clients' statements where I've seen that family maximum clearly has gone up every time I look at it annually. I think it does. I think it goes up by the 8%, but I don't know for sure. It's a great question.
So the family max is not just twice the maximum?
It's not. It's not. And the way it works is that if you have, there's benefits for Social Security benefits for children basically under the age of 19. So if you start your Social Security benefit and you have children under that age, they also are eligible for a benefit. And then, as we'll talk about the spousal benefits later, there's also a spousal benefit. So the Social Security Administration kind of looks at a cap for everybody. And if you have multiple children that are under that age, you might not get the full retirement benefit that you would think for the whole family, because they do cap that off. So it's confusing. I weighed whether I wanted to present that or not for this presentation, because it gets so complicated. But I'll check into that. I think it does get the 8% a year increase, though. Pretty sure. Let's see. This is just another way, again, to illustrate why delay benefits, meaning when you would start to take it. And it just shows if you claimed at age 62 in this column, and if you claimed at age 70 over here, and then the benefits at these various ages, you can again see how the difference is and your monthly benefit can increase. So, and again, at 8% a year, at least initially, till you get to age 70, it can be pretty substantial. Now, let's talk about the impact of delayed benefits. So another example to walk through. So we have Michael at age 62. They call him the higher earner. His PIA, so primary insurance amount, $2,500. What will his benefit be if he starts at 62, starts at 66, or starts at 70? So let's go to the numbers on this, and I'll read this in case it's a little hard to read in the back. So we've got, for the first column, we just lay out the different scenarios. The starting benefit at age 62 is $1,875 a month. Starting at 66, full retirement age, there's the $2,500 a month. Starting at age 70, the last year where you can get that benefit of that increase would be $3,300. So if you look at the monthly income, again, at age 85, 2.7% cost of living adjustment. You can see for age 62, it's up to $3,460. Age 66 is $4,614. Age 70 is $6,090. And then again, you can see the cumulative benefits. So your difference between age 62 and age 70 is almost $250,000. So it's just simply running the numbers on those assumptions is where we're coming up with that. Yes? That's a great question. So the question was, is this adjusted for a possible reduction in the year 2034? It is not. So that might be a dangerous assumption to make, depending on what they do. Yes, sir?
And you're also assuming that Michael,
yep,
no longer works after age 62, or his 35 years is as full as he's going to get, so it doesn't matter if he worked or did not work.
That's a great question. So one of the assumptions in here is that Michael is, let's just say, has hit that 35 years at the highest earnings level. He could still continue working, but for this purpose, his benefits would be set. It's a good question. Now, what if you apply before full retirement age? So this is kind of repetitive to a degree, what we covered on the other slides, but I think it's really important. So for full retirement age of age 66, and this is the years that it applies to in terms of when you're born, that reduction again is 75%. And then you can see the other reductions that take place. If you wait till age 63, the reduction is 20%. So you get 80% of that primary insurance amount benefit. And then you can see at age 66, it's 100%. And these are examples. So $2,400 is the benefit a month. At 25% reduction, it's $1,800. And you can just see the subsequent numbers at the older the age is between 62 and 66 with the subsequent reduction in percentage benefit. Now, this is the same slide as the one before, except this is for those that are at full retirement age of 67, which is defined as being born in 1960 or later. The change in the numbers is that the prior page, let me flip back up so you can see the difference. Let's focus on age 62. This one says 70%. The prior page was 75%. So what's happening is that the way Social Security is somewhat balancing their funds is that the discount is a higher discount for those that have that full retirement age of 67. So these numbers adjust a little bit. You can see there's tweaks if we were to compare the two slides and then the subsequent numbers. So it's just something, you know, just more to be aware of, that as that full retirement age increases, those discounts are greater. Now we're going to talk about some reasons not to file before full retirement age. So the first thing is that, as we've talked about, your benefits will be reduced. And then as I go through these slides, I'm just going to add a point to each one that'll be in bold. Now, if you work and you're before your full retirement age, for every $1 in benefits will be withheld for every $2 you earn over $16,920. Let me simplify that. So if you're working and you earn over $16,920 and you want to collect Social Security before your full retirement age, you're going to have a reduction in your benefit. That's just the way Social Security works. They're trying to encourage people to work longer is really the concept behind what they're doing here. Now, a lot of times whenever you read articles about Social Security, they'll talk about these rules, these earnings limits is what they're called, and they'll say you lose your benefit. Well, it's not really true. You do lose it for those years before full retirement age. What Social Security does, though, is they take what you've had in a reduced benefit and they tack it on the back end at age 70. So you kind of get the money down the road, so at least you're not entirely losing it. But if you've claimed Social Security and this is an issue for you and you end up losing your entire benefit or a significant amount, what you've done is you've started the Social Security clock, and those pages I showed you before where you get the higher benefits by waiting longer, you've lost that entirely. That's really the key thing you lose in this situation. You'll get the money back they withhold down the road, but the real key is that you've started your Social Security clock on the earnings and you can't wait, you know, for those higher benefit years. So this is the part that's tricky, but you want to be very careful about this if you're still working and want to file before your full retirement age. Now the next slide, just building on to that, also too, and we'll talk about spouse benefits very shortly, is that the way it works for surviving spouse, so if one spouse passes away, basically the surviving spouse will get the greater of their benefit or the deceased spouse's benefit. So we'll dive into that a little bit deeper in a few minutes. But if you file before your full retirement age and you are earning money and you lose some of your benefits, your surviving spouse's benefit might be lower as well. We'll talk about that a little more. Now, a reason not to file at your full retirement age, same concept as what we've been just talking about. If you're working at full retirement age, the rule changes. You lose $1 in benefits will be withheld for every $3 you earn over $44,880. These numbers, these earnings limits are inflated every year. These are 2017 numbers. I realize this is confusing stuff. But basically, if you're earning money before full retirement age, taking Social Security, be careful about how this works. You want to look in this a little further. These are just the actual numbers for it. Now, what if you apply after full retirement age? We've kind of talked about this already. You will get that 8% annual delayed credit until age 70 for those that have a full retirement age of age 66. So again, here are the numbers, very similar to the other page that I showed before in terms of what that can mean to you. So you basically get 8% a year of a higher benefit every year between full retirement age and age 70. And these, again, the last column is just an example with $2,400, what that could actually mean to you. Now, same looking page as the last one, except the full retirement age is now 67. So here's the problem. Another way Social Security is trying to keep their trust funds somewhat in check. Let me go back one page. For full retirement age of 66, age 70 is basically a 32% higher benefit. For those full retirement age of age 67, at age 70, it's a 24% higher benefit. So it's not like this goes out to age 71 another year because full retirement age has gone up. They've kept that age 70 as the last year you can earn a higher benefit with that 8% a year. So now you have one less year. So that again just applies for those who were born in 1960 or later. So now when to apply for Social Security. So just a couple of, you know, repeating some of the points we've made. If you apply early, your benefit will start lower and stays lower for life. I showed a couple of those examples starting at 62, 66, and 67. That's exactly what I'm talking about. The COLA, that stands for cost of living adjustment. So obviously they magnify the impact based on whenever you start. No matter when you start, the cost of living is an important feature. But again, if you're starting at a higher amount, that cost of living will mean more to you over time. And then again, we'll talk about the survivor benefits in a little more detail. And actually, I'll just leave this part alone, so we'll dive into this very shortly and it'll make more sense. So here we go for spousal benefits. And then we'll go into survivor benefits. So this is where you have a little more planning opportunities in terms of thinking through what might make more sense for you. So the spouse of a worker is entitled to Social Security, that's entitled to Social Security, they can claim what's called a spousal benefit. Now what is that? So when it says, when we're talking about being entitled, that means one of the workers is eligible for Social Security and they filed for their benefits. And I'll have some examples that'll clearly, at least more clearly explain this. Let's start with this example. So we have Jack and Jill are married. They're both age 66. So Jack has paid into Social Security all his life. His primary insurance amount, there's our $2,400 amount again. Jill has never worked. Once Jack files for Social Security benefits, Jill can also file for a spousal benefit. So the way it would work in this specific case is that the spousal benefit is 50% of Jack's PIA, or primary insurance amount of $2,400, equating to $1,200. So basically a spousal benefit allows a benefit up to 50% of the other spouse's benefit. Now let's go through a little bit more on this. So along with your retirement benefit, where if you start at 62, you get that discount, the same thing applies for a spousal benefit. So in this example, here's the age of the spouse applying for the spousal benefit. At age 66, assuming that's full retirement age, there's the 50% number we've been talking about. However, if you apply at age 62, it's 35% of the other spouse's primary insurance amount. So again, there's a discount. The same concept, just some different numbers we're talking about. And you can see the percentage, the discount is different for each age before full retirement age. Now, some other rules. So the primary worker, again, they must have filed for their own benefit. The spouse must be at least 62 years old to get that reduced benefit, which is that 35% number I showed you a couple of slides ago, or age 66 for a full benefit of 50% of the worker's primary insurance amount. The spousal benefit's based on the worker's PIA, not their own benefit, or their, not the actual benefit of the spouse who's made the filing. What this really means, I think it explains it on this slide. Yep. So no delayed credits on spousal benefits after full retirement age. What that's saying is that 50% number for the spouse, it doesn't go up if it's taken at age 66. It stays at 50%. Even if the other spouse is age 70, it's not going to be based upon an age 70 benefit. It's based on age 66. It's confusing. But if you can just keep in mind, the spousal benefit could be up to 50% of the other spouse's benefit. That's a really good starting point. Yes?
This is assuming that both spouses are still living.
It is. Okay. Great question. Yep.
So their benefit would be like $3,600 a month with the 24 and half that would be $1,200.
Yep. So the question is, was it assuming both spouses are still alive? And it is. And then, yes, kind of the bottom line in that example I had before, so the primary was $2,400 a month. 50% of that, if you just went with that assumption being $1,200, the total family benefit, if you will, would be $3,600 a month in that example. Yes, sir?
Where's the $1,200 coming from?
The 50% rule that Social Security has that the other spouse is allowed to have on their benefit. So just kind of a rule that Social Security has made that the other spouse can earn up to 50% of the other spouse's benefit. Now, we'll talk about this in a second, is that if that other spouse also worked, and let's say their PIA is $2,000 a month, in my example from before, the way it works is that the other spouse gets the higher of the 50% of spousal benefit or their own benefit. So you just have to kind of run the numbers on that. Yes, Mike?
In your example where
yep.
the wife didn't work.
Yep.
And they start filing this benefit and they get the $3,600. The husband dies.
Yep.
What does she get anything after that?
That's a great question. So what happens if the spouse, the higher earning spouse, passes away? Is that was what it was, Mike, right? So in that case, and we'll talk about this with the survivor benefits, which is next, but in that, it's a good question to tie into this, is that when the spouse dies that had the higher benefit, the surviving spouse gets the higher of the two. So in my example, let's just say it stayed at $2,400 to make the example easy. That would be what the other spouse would have continuing. So the $1,200 would go away in my example, but the higher of the two would stay for the surviving spouse. It's a really, really important concept. Yes?
It's probably a weird question, but I don't understand why spouses are getting benefits that they haven't paid into it. Is it based on the premise that women are 40 to 35 when women worked in the home, and why aren't they updating that? Because that would save a lot of money for Social Security.
Well, the reality of it is, though, you have the flip side, too, now, is that times have changed, and sometimes it's the husband that stays at home. And so it works both ways in terms of the survivor benefit. But in your example, if you have, with a lot of families here, you have both spouses working now, then it's going to be the higher of the two. And most likely, in a lot of cases, it'll probably be the individual's own benefit will be greater than the 50% of spousal benefit. So it kind of goes away. But it is a way that was, based on the 1930s, whenever the laws were written, and you usually had one spouse that was working and one that was not. That was exactly the concept behind it. Absolutely. Yeah. You're right. They haven't really changed that part of the rule, really hasn't changed over time. But I think you see it less being claimed because of that fact. Yes? Yep.
They get half.
That's correct.
And if they did work some, they still might.
Maybe the 50% is exactly right. That's right. If it's always going to be the higher of the two, so that's very true. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to understand this. If the
husband good
is 66
luck.
And the wife is, say, 62.
Sure.
And he takes his retirement, he's getting $2,400.
Yep.
Get half of his, or is it 35% because she's only 62?
Great question. So again, on the spousal benefit, one spouse claims is 66, the other one is 62, the lower earning of the two. It would be that 35% number that they would receive based on the one chart I had where it was kind of discounted again before full retirement age. So full retirement age would be 50%. Anything less, there will be a discount that will be taken.
Well, the second part of that is, so say she takes it at 35, she has her own. Can she let her own build up and take his at 62?
We'll cover that issue. Let me show you. I think I have a slide that kind of deals with that and shows that. I think I cover that. Let me see if I come up with this next. So made that point. There is a marriage requirement. You have to be married for 1 year for all these rules to take effect. And what if the spouse is also entitled to Social Security on their own work record? If the spouse applies before full retirement age, she'll receive her reduced benefits first. If the spousal benefit would be higher, she'll be paid the higher amount. And then here's an example. So we have Jack and Jill are married. Jack is 66, Jill is 62. Jack's PIA is 2,400. Jill's PIA is 800. Jack files for benefits at age 66. Jill files at age 62. So Jill is going to, this is the answer to your question, I believe. Jill receives her own reduced benefit of 600, which in this case they have that discount of 25% of the 800, plus a spousal add-on of 280 for a total benefit of $880. And then we actually have the calculation down below. So that's the way it works. It's confusing. You have so many different scenarios for this. And prior to a couple of years ago, there were a whole host of options that you could have. And I actually have them covered towards the end, but I'm probably not going to cover it because it's not going to apply as much these days. Yes, sir?
So in that scenario, if Jill waited until she was 66, she would get half a Jack.
Right.
She's better off waiting.
That could be the case. So if she waited till her full retirement age, this is what gets tricky. You know, when you're doing this, the nice thing is that Social Security website has some examples of calculators on their website. You can try to play around with it, but you have to be very careful you're putting in the right data because it's so complicated. All these different rules we're talking about. Now, let's talk about just a couple of things on divorced spouse benefits. So the first requirement is that the marriage had to have lasted 10 years or more. The person receiving the divorced spouse benefit is currently unmarried. So the ex-spouse is entitled to Social Security or disability benefits and is at least age 62. So there's that magic number again. The earliest point is age 62. So a couple of other points on this. More than one ex-spouse can receive benefits on the same worker's record. So that's kind of interesting. The benefits paid to one ex-spouse do not affect the benefits paid to that worker, the current spouse, or other ex-spouses. So the question I get sometimes from our clients that have been through and qualify for this is that the worker that all the benefits are being based on does not have any idea behind the scenes that the ex-spouse is claiming off the record at a certain age or what the dollar amount is. If they know the rules, they realize this could be happening, but there's privacy on this part. It's not like they have any idea what's going on. I get that question a lot, understandably so. So all these divorced spouse rules, they stop if the spouse gets remarried. So I think that's a really important part. So again, 10 years of marriage is kind of a starting point. If there's a divorce, then you want to look into this a little bit more. Now here's the part about survivor benefits. And I've got about maybe 10 or 15 more slides I want to make sure I cover here, and then we'll have plenty of time for question and answer. A couple of these things we've already talked about. So the amount of survivor benefit depends on a couple of things. When the deceased spouse originally claimed their benefit, called the original benefit, or when the widow claims her survivor benefit or actual benefit. So let's go through an example. Jack and Jill are married. Jack's PIA, again, is $2,400 a month. Jack dies at age 70. If he had claimed his benefit at age 70, Jill's original survivor benefit would be based on his benefit at the time of his death, or in this case, $3,168. If he had claimed his benefit at age 62, again, that earliest age, Jill's original survivor benefit would be based on 82.5% of Jack's primary insurance amount, or $1,980. Obviously, I didn't make this stuff up, but it's just the way it works. Even going through this, it's almost laughable trying to have everybody understand all this the first time through. But I guess the key thing is that on the survivor benefits, again, all the same discounts kind of conceptually will apply. Some of the specifics work a little bit differently in terms of the percentages. Now, the actual survivor benefit based on when the widow claims the benefit, just building on that last slide, here are the various percentage reductions. One thing I didn't mention before is that for a survivor benefit, it could actually start at age 60 for the surviving spouse as well. And then you can see the various reductions in benefit based on the different ages. And you can just see how the numbers work out. You have a reduction, again, starting at age 60. So it's basically almost a 30% reduction of that benefit at the primary insurance amount for the person who passed away. So a couple of key things. So individual Social Security benefits do stop at death. So Jack passes away, his benefits go away. Then, as we were talking about before, the surviving spouse gets their surviving benefit equal to the deceased spouse's benefit if that's the higher number. So if Jack dies, Jill's original survivor benefit will equal Jack's at the time of his death. Jill will receive the survivor benefit again if she claims that her full retirement age or later. And then if Jill has a benefit, and she will, she either have the spousal benefit or her own benefit, her benefit will stop because she will get the higher of the two benefits. That's always kind of the way the rules will work on this. Yes, ma'am.
Question. Mm-hmm. So Jack intends to file for benefits at 70, if he passes away right before 70th birthday. What happens?
That's a great question. So in that case, if he passes away before he starts, and the intention was to be at age 70 and he passes away at age 69, then it's going to be the benefits that are in place at that time, I believe. That's a really good question. I never thought about that before. I think that's right. I can double check that for you, though, if you want me to follow up. Yeah. Yeah, no, it's a good question. So another key point. So if the widow's own retirement benefit is higher, she will keep her own benefit, just what we've been talking about. So maximizing Social Security for the surviving spouse. So the higher earning spouse, this is what you might want to consider if this applies in your situation, is that if you have a higher earning spouse delays their benefit to age 70, they're going to get the highest amount possible. So the nice thing about that is that if you plan it out that way and your finances allow you to, then the highest benefit possible is at age 70. So from a family standpoint, the way the actuarial tables work is that for a husband and wife, it's projected that one of the spouses will live into their 90s. So if you think about it, not just from the one person, the higher earning spouse's standpoint, but you think about it from the two spouse standpoint, if you can do it, waiting to age 70 for the higher earner can make sense because that benefit will carry through for two lives at the higher amount, getting that 8% bump up from full retirement age to age 70. Now again, health issues might not allow that. Maybe the finances don't allow that. Maybe it's gonna, if you do that, it's gonna cause you to have to draw down your assets sooner. You have to think about all of that, but hopefully you can see where maybe that could make sense in certain cases, is trying to leverage the higher earning spouse's benefit. Covered most of this. So if Jill switches to her survivor benefit, her benefit stops if it's the higher of the two. If Jill retains her own retirement benefit because it's higher, then Jack's will stop. So it's always, again, the higher of the two when you're dealing with these spousal planning rules. So just make the point here, as I was talking about a minute ago, make claiming decisions as a couple. Think about it strategically from that standpoint. And again, there's software programs you run. We run these for clients where we analyze what assumptions do we want to make, and let's take a look at the numbers to see how compelling it is. And as I showed on some of the slides before, I mean, you could be talking $100,000, $200,000 over a longer time frame. So it's a significant decision to make. So just making a mention, take advantage of spousal benefit as rules allow. Plan for the surviving spouse's income. So think about the entire picture, not just Social Security. Think about retirement assets, because at age 70 and a half, you're going to be required to take money out. Think about if you have a pension, think about that part as well. If the spouse passes away that has the pension, did you set it up that some kind of a benefit payment would continue for the surviving spouse? So you have to think about all these different moving parts and make a decision on what's going to apply. Is there still life insurance that exists? That can maybe play into the situation too. And just make the point, integrate Social Security into the rest of your retirement plan, which is what we've been talking about. And I'm going to pass on this part because these are really complicated filing strategies for spouses that went away in the last year. A couple of things I will mention for those of you that might have read up on Social Security. There used to be a rule called file and suspend. I'm not going to dive into it. I'm happy to talk about it, but it doesn't really apply anymore for a majority of people. It was a way to leverage benefits for spouses. It doesn't exist anymore except for, and I'm just going to fast forward to a couple of slides here, is that this went away. No, this strategy doesn't apply, no spousal benefits to be paid on suspensions requested after April 30, 2016. So if you're familiar with this strategy, you'll know what I'm talking about, and then this could apply for you. But for the most part, this type of strategy has gone away. And I don't want to leave it in the dark on this, but we'd be here for another hour to go through these strategies because they're really complicated. Then there's also what's called a restricted claim that has also basically gone away in the last year. So the way this works is you had to be age 62 before the end of 2015 to take a spousal benefit if this strategy would work. So it does get extremely complicated And I had to weigh whether I wanted to even go down this road for this, but for the most part, a lot of people won't have the supply anymore. If you think that might, then it would warrant really, I think, a separate discussion. So with that, any questions? It's a loaded question itself. Yes, sir.
My wife and I are near 70. We both got no children benefits.
No children benefits. That's correct. No children benefits if both spouses pass away.
Now, this is 6.2%.
Yep.
Has that been that percentage the whole since?
No, that's a good question. That 6.2% Social Security tax rate has not always been at that rate. I think it's been that way since the 90s. I'm going to be off a little bit on that, but it has gone up over time. It used to be, I think the last increase went from 4.2% or something like that.
That's taken out of my pay.
That's correct.
So is there a calculation that shows what I put into it?
If you go on to the Social Security website, I believe it'll tell you what you've paid in over time in terms of just an accumulated contribution.
So if that is,
yeah, I mean, that's yeah, no, I get it. I can appreciate that, too. It's the way they set up the system that there's no, you know, child benefit, if you will, that would continue on for their lifetime or whatever the case is.
But if children are under, if you die, the children are minors, but they get money until they're 18.
There is, yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Now, if you die young before retirement, does your spouse?
There is the surviving benefit. There is a death benefit that does pay out. It's not very large. I forget the amount. I think it's like under $300, I believe, in that case. It's a one time. I think it used to be $255, and I don't know if they've inflated that. Is that what it still is? Yeah.
They get nothing monthly the rest of their life at all.
Right. So now, again, if you have the children that are under age 19, you know, those parts of the benefits would still, you know, apply. But yeah, unfortunately, it's not really set up from a standpoint of really the children over a longer time frame. Yes?
How about if the children are over 19, but they were receiving disability?
Good question. I didn't cover really much in terms of Social Security disability. I'm not sure of that answer. I don't want to misspeak on that. I think I might know the answer on that one, but I didn't go down that road just to keep the complexity level down in terms of Social Security disability. It's a whole different ball of wax. Yes?
Mine's twofold. You mentioned the 4% once you start withdrawing on your IRA. What if you have, like I do, a traditional IRA, both in a bank and a mutual fund? Do I have to withdraw from both, or is the amount lumped together and then the 4% of that lumped together?
Right. So the question is, if you have an IRA at a bank, at a CD, we'll say, another IRA with a mutual fund, can you withdraw from both, or can it be from one? In that example, you can actually take the two required distribution calculations if you want to pull it from one source. And the 4% number that I used as a withdrawal rate in that first year, the way that actually works is that you add up the balance of your retirement accounts as of the prior year, and then the IRS gives you a divisor based on life expectancy. In that first year, it's 27.4 is the divisor, which is where I get my 4% number from. Then each year going forward, you take the year-end balances of the retirement accounts with a new divisor. That divisor goes down by 0.9 every year, so your percentage withdrawal starts to creep up. Just add a few points to that of what I talked about before. That's right, a higher percentage, that all things equal if it's the same balance, which it'll fluctuate, but yeah, it would be a higher withdrawal rate. So, but you are allowed to add the IRA account balances in that example. You can add them together, calculate that withdrawal, and take it from one account. We do that a lot with our clients. We'll just aggregate and pick the most strategic source, whatever that might be, or pull from each one. I mean, you could do either or.
Second yep. part real quick was just, I'm working now, but I could, you know, start at 66, I guess. Mm-hmm. What if I wanted to wait till 68? And then stop working, and instead of doing my Social Security, is it advantageous to live off my IRA and savings and postpone the Social Security till 70, or is it best to postpone the IRA and
right.
start the Social Security?
It'll depend, you know, in terms of how you want to look at that, but a couple of rules of thumb I would use is that if you're in a relatively low tax bracket, you might want to consider withdrawing from the IRA. You know, and then leverage that 8% bump up a year you get, because you can't find any investment that's going to return 8% guaranteed every year. So under that concept, you can certainly look at your IRA account. But if you're in a, you know, a tax bracket that starts to eat up more of that withdrawal because of that, that would offset that benefit over time. So really, it's a very personalized decision, but those are a couple of rules of thumb that you'd want to use for that purpose. So it just depends. Yes?
If you're going to retire, say, at 70,
uh-huh.
you have to wait until your birthday. Like, if your birthday's in January, you have to wait until you're the full month that you're that age.
Yeah, at that age, and you can. I think you can start the application in 3 months beforehand, but I mean, okay. Right.
But you just have to wait that month.
Yeah, if you want to really leverage that ultimately highest benefit at age 70, right.
It's the first day of that month that you
can. I believe it is. Yeah, I believe it's that first day. Yeah,
so
kind of similar.
The month that you turn, not your day.
Right, I believe that's exactly right. Yep. And if you're, yep, sir.
So if I'm 68 and I'm 5,
yep.
I die, the survivor benefit my wife doesn't get my Social Security benefit.
You know, let me double check that for you. It's a really important question. I want to make sure that I'm right on that in terms of what would happen. So the question is, again, if one spouse is age 68, and they haven't started Social Security yet, they pass away, what does the surviving spouse get? Are they just, they're stuck because that the primary earner, if you will, didn't start yet or not? So I'm gonna double check that. I just don't wanna misspeak on that. It's a really good question. I think,
to start
the benefit. I think it's gonna, let's talk afterwards. I'll make sure I get your question answered. I just didn't think of that in terms of the presentation. That's a really good question. Yes, Gina?
Just a thought, since everybody has this form, as these questions come up that you're asking people to look into, you want to write
the question on the same
form so that you can get
that. Yeah, but I'm going to double check that. I have the answer. I know where I can get it really easily. But I think you can see, though, on that, you know, the spousal benefit issue, it is, you know, really important to try to make the good, right decision there to leverage that higher earning benefit for the two lifetimes. I think that's a really, really important concept. I don't think most people realize that's the way it works, that the survivor gets the higher of the two. But it's a great question if the spouse dies before taking any benefit because they're waiting to age 70, what happens? And I'll get you the answer. Yes, ma'am. Right.
Without revealing my age, what if you're smack in the middle? Is it some incremental?
It is. Yeah, it's a great question. Some of the slides were talking about the full retirement age applies if you were born in these age ranges. It's not that it's the same. It is proportional, you know, in terms of if you're on the earlier side of that or the later side of it, right in the middle. Yeah, I just didn't want to keep the slides somewhat,
no.
somewhat presentable in that respect. That's a good question. Yes, sir?
Back about half a dozen slides ago.
Yep.
In spousal benefits, if the younger spouse is, say, considerably younger, mm-hmm. when the younger one lower earning at 62, and say they want to start their Social Security at that point on their own, mm-hmm. separate from the higher earning spouse, they'll get a reduced amount, I don't know, 75% of what they would get.
Right.
And then you had another part that I never saw before, that there's like a $280 or something addition as part of the other spouse?
280 addition.
It was on one of your slides.
Oh, yeah, that was, I know which one.
And I never saw that before.
Yeah. It was before. Yeah, I know, you're totally right. No, I know exactly which slide you mean.
On there.
Right.
Is that something you need to take, or is that something you...
Here it is.
That one there.
Yep. So what this is saying...
and add-on thing. I don't understand that. So if you take that add-on thing, that permanently reduces a benefit?
So where this gets complicated in this example, so Jill is getting her reduced... It's almost a play on the words. Because what's actually happening here is that ultimately Jill is going to get the higher of her benefit... or the spousal benefit, which follows all those rules I went through at the beginning. This is just a play on the words. This is formally how Social Security would call it. So they're saying she would get $600 would be her benefit, 75% of her PIA from above here. But because if you calculated the spousal benefit on Jack's 2,400, reduce it because she's age 62, the total number that would be is actually $880. It's a play on words. That's kind of the ultimately higher, that's the max she's gonna be able to receive. They technically say it's 600 is hers and 280 is the spousal benefit. It's just a play on words. It kind of follows the rule for the spousal benefit that I covered, where the spouse was taking it at age 62 off of the other spouse's earnings. That's really essentially it.
So yep. My question, is that a permanent thing that she has to live with, that amount forever?
Right. So if she's starting.
Can she take the 75% of hers, not add on that spousal, and then switch over when she's 66?
It's a great question in terms of, can you kind of hold off on the spousal part and wait? The old, what I'll call the old claiming strategies, and I'm not diving into, had some really interesting scenarios that would allow some really, really nice planning techniques. They've taken those away in the last, you know, year. Yeah, it is. It is a big bummer because it was a major planning strategy.
That's what I thought.
That'll be great. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Could she take his spousal half and delay her until 70 and get her max?
Great question. So the question would be, is could she take the spousal and wait till age 70 to take her higher amount? Again, that's under the old claiming strategies. They've taken that away. Yep. Yeah. It's really good thinking because it would allow for a much higher benefit. Mm-hmm. They've removed that rule because of that. So for some reason, a couple of years ago, somebody wrote a book on Social Security strategies that covered a lot of things we're talking about in this example. And it really did a great job outlining these wonderful strategies you could do. Congress got a hold of the book, and this is no kidding. And somebody went through it, or maybe their staffer went through and explained what was going on, and within a year, they eliminated those benefits. And it was about a year ago whenever they went away. It's a true story how that actually came about. So a lot of really intricate strategies for spouses disappeared. So, yep. And Gina's giving me the hook. But I'm happy to but I'm happy to stay.
Had only the hour, so I didn't want to make you feel
sure.
Awkward if you had to get up and leave. I know Jim will stay and answer some questions. I thank you tremendously. I'm sure
you're welcome.
Everybody has.
You're welcome.
If you need to hear this one more time,
come back tonight.
Same place. Come on back. But I mean, you made it logical, but just so much to read.
Try to. Right.
So thank you very much.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
You.
Thank you for all the questions. That's great. Now I've confused everybody.
No.